Yes, guys, I hope the stream is going on. Can you put it in the comment box if the stream is going fine right now? Because I see that the stream is going on green. So I think it should be working right now. Just check and put it in the comment box if it's working fine. We'll continue from where we left off. Yes, guys, so you people haven't missed anything. So what we were talking about was only the importance of this word financial instruments and how it has a lot of weightage, and where I was talking about just how the balance sheet would look like. And I just wanted to mark what are the items which normally gets covered under this standard, that is Ind AS 32, 107 and 109. So that is where we were. So I'll just keep starting upon it. So when I look at current assets, we have inventory. At the same time, we have trade receivables. Same way, we would have other current assets. I'm not looking at what would be the current assets because there could be loans and advances and all other items which are expected to be realized within 12 months. So within 12 months, you would get this. These are our current assets. So if you look at the asset side, guys, look at this asset side, non-current assets and current assets. And I'm just marking on the asset side and go back to the liabilities because the liabilities have much more weightage as far as financial instruments is concerned. But on the asset side, if I'm looking at your property, plant and equipment, like you always know, is as per your Ind AS 16, correct? Your investment property goes as per Ind AS 40, correct? Now your intangible asset is as per Ind AS 38. And your other non-current assets, which are expected to be realized, this forms part of our financial instruments. This is where we fit in our the standard of Ind AS 32, 107 and 109. Yeah, Nitin Bala, here we go. And looking at your current assets, if I come to, your inventory goes as per Ind AS 2, the most common standard or easiest standard for any student out there. The rest of the current assets, whatever you have, will again go into the logic of financial instruments. So if I look at, I am basically understanding the form of how our financial statements would be, and we are here to looking at what are non-current assets and current assets on the asset side, and look at the number of items which are being covered by the standard. All the current assets except inventory and all non-current assets other than property, plant and equipment, investment property and intangible assets will be coming to be a part of financial instruments. Look at a company like Infosys. Now, what do you think you would find on the asset side of Infosys? Would you find a major amount put under property, plant and equipment? Absolutely no, because all they own is a building and hardware equipment that they have. But the major asset for them is basically embedded into the trade receivables that they have, the deposits that they make, the advances which they give. Imagine when I say Infosys is a debt-free company. Imagine when I say this, that Infosys is a complete debt-free company. That means they have a 0 rupee of debt which is with them. So from there, if you understand that the asset side is so rich in their balance sheet that they did not even have 1 rupee of a liability with them, that creates an entire logic. That builds up the entire logic for you. So if I look at the current assets and non-current assets, you will understand that these are the only two items which are coming under the financial instruments per se. But when I look at the liability side, that makes it even more interesting, because if I go to equity and liabilities, I'd always start with shareholder funds, which is my equity part. Under my shareholders funds, we normally see share capital, could be equity or preference. Along with that, we'll also find reserves and surplus. Correct? In our Ind AS terms, we call this reserves and surplus as other equity. That is a change in nomenclature because of a lot of things which will happen in Ind AS 109. You'll understand why this name reserve and surplus is no longer used. Other equity comes into picture. Why did it become other equity? I'll explain you as we progress through the standard, because this standard will definitely explain the logic of other equity out there. Then we start looking at something called as your non-current liabilities. Guys, can you put me in the chat box if the class is visible and we are going fine? Yeah, I see from Jinardhan who says that we can hear you, sir. Thank you. If anyone has a trouble, please let me know. Non-current liabilities. Under non-current liabilities, what do you find? It's a long-term liability like your term loans or anything. My term loans. Then I can have my advances from customers. Then I can have my employee benefits, which are long term. Guys, your gratuity liabilities and everything is a long term one, correct? It's a long term liability under non current liabilities for them, because normally your pensions and gratuities or any other employee benefits, which are not short term benefits under your Ind AS 19, which normally comes under your employee benefits out there. Now, if I go into my current liabilities, guys, keep taking down the notes, okay? Under current liabilities, we can normally have trade payables. You can have outstanding expenses, a normal, very regular account head. And you can have provisions out here. Now you look at this. this entire liability side, I'll just mark this employee benefits here for Ind AS 19. And this provisions towards the end, I'll mark it for Ind AS 37. Whatever other liabilities that you find here, which I've written in the balance sheet on the liability side, are all covered by financial instruments. Yes, your share capital of equity and preference will also get covered under financial instruments. Your term loans will definitely get covered under financial instruments. Trade payables will also come under financial instruments, just like outstanding expenses, which will also be a part of financial instruments. This part out here, when I have advances from customers, these are emerging from contracts with customers, so I take it under 115. So if you look at the liability side, is even more coverage of financial instruments than on the SSR. Now, if you observe, I'll put a very blunt and a blind statement out there. Any given company will have at least 60% of their total assets and liabilities, which will be governed by financial instruments. I'm right now doing the Ind AS transition for another company, which has an adoption date as 1st April 19. It's still in the process. I mean, among this lockdown, it's even better, working on this, because that's the only client which is actually going right now well. So when I talk about that company, has about 88% of the entire assets and liabilities, which are only within the financial instrument. So that is how the financial instrument becomes one of the most important concepts. Or I would say the most important concept, I wouldn't say one of the most, because there is no standard or no other paragraph which is having a much higher significance than what financial instruments have. So that is how significant we are looking into financial instruments. Now this financial instrument, like you always know, is divided into three standards, right? One which we deal with as Ind AS 32, even we will start with this. And then we have Ind AS 109, which is the second most important part. The least of its importance goes into the third standard, 107. I say the least of importance, okay? So what is contained under this 32, 107 and 109 is what we have to understand. When I'm looking at 32, I'm basically intending to look at the definitions of financial instruments. And then I will start looking at a very, very important conflict, which is sometimes very difficult to understand if I read for myself, is the difference between an equity and a financial liability. Like everyone knows, equity should be presented under shareholder funds, under either the share capital or the other equity, while financial liability should be classified into current and non-current and has to be classified much below in the balance sheet. Now, there could be an instrument which will confuse you whether it should be classified as an equity instrument or whether it should be classified as a financial liability. So that will be the second part that I will be discussing about. The third important part that we will discuss about is about something called as compound financial instruments. And something related to that called as split accounting. All this we're going to cover today. what is split accounting, what are compound instruments, how are they taken care of, we will start discussing today itself. Then we will talk about offset of financial assets and liabilities. Guys, though all the first three topics I will take in a chronological order, I will not take this in the same order. I'll bring this concept of offset of financial assets and liabilities probably towards the end. Okay? Except this point number D, where I talk about offset of financial assets and liabilities, I will continue with the remaining other parts of Ind AS 32 in the same order in which I have written out there. So first we will discuss about the definition. Then we will discuss about the conflict between equity and financial liability. Then we will go into compound financial instruments and split accounting. It's the same chronological order. I am putting this offset of financial assets and liabilities aside because it requires a little more understanding of Ind AS 109 to understand this point of offsetting. Offset is nothing but set off, man. As simple as that. Yeah, maybe the term might be confusing, but it's as simple as set off. Now, when I look at Ind AS 109, I'll first look at classification. Very important, a time consuming concept, probably we should be covering it today. Classification of financial assets and financial liabilities. You'll have to talk about classification of financial assets first and then come into financial liabilities on a subsequent part. Then we talk about, I'm not going for the recognition immediately. I'll go in for the measurement. And then I will talk about the recognition and derecognition. Then I'll go further into the concept of hedge accounting. And then I'll look at something called as embedded derivatives. Embedded derivatives. They are also called as hybrid contracts. Don't confuse between these two. Don't confuse between offset of your compound financial instruments and embedded derivatives. Both are complete different concepts, so don't get confused. In Ind AS 109, I will discuss about only the disclosures, which I will just run through because disclosures is not a very important concept as far as the standard is concerned. So we will spend 99% of our time in the standard for the next 3 days only discussing about Ind AS 32 and 109. These two become one of the most important concepts of the standard. And remember, guys, each and every paragraph that I explain is of high significance as far as the standard is concerned. I'm going to take this down. I'll give you a second to take it down fast. Just trying to take your comments before you take down notes. in the chronology of the CAS, guys, probably I'll take the embedded derivative first and then I'll take the head decanting, okay? So shall we get into the concept then? It's almost 7:45 and now we are getting into the concept. Now let's start making some sense. Now let's start understanding one by one what exactly we are talking about, what is a financial instrument, how do we discuss about this concept. So let me start with first taking up my definition part of it. Under my definitions, the first thing I'm going to start with is first understanding what is a financial instrument. Guys, let's say I have gone and borrowed certain amount from a bank. Okay, I borrowed a certain amount from a bank. This contract of lending and borrowing, this contract of lending and borrowing funds has actually given rise to a financial instrument out there. How did this contract become a financial instrument? Very simple. Look at this logic. It is my responsibility, since I borrowed it from the bank, my responsibility is to pay back to the bank, to make sure that I am repaying my loan to the bank along with the interest. So it created an obligation on me. I have an obligation to pay. Now think from the banker's side. A banker would say, I have a right to receive cash. I have a right to receive cash, which is my amount which I lent along with the interest. So an obligation on my part, on this party, and a receivable or a right to the other party is basically a contract of financial instrument. In a simple sense, let's say I sold a particular pen, this pen to you, for 100 rupees, let's say. This transaction also has a financial instrument in it. What is that? Once I've given you the pen, once I've delivered the pen into your hands and you got control over this particular pen, now I would say I have a right to receive that 100 rupees. And you would say you have an obligation to receive that 100 rupees. So basically, instrument, financial instruments are nothing but their contracts. Their contracts which give rise to contractual rights and contractual obligations. A contract always gives rise to a contractual right and a contractual obligation. A contractual right to one party and a contractual obligation to other party. So a contract which gives rise to a contractual right to one party is called as a financial asset. While an obligation under a contract is basically called as a financial liability. the contract which gives rise to a contractual right and an obligation to one party and the other party is basically a financial instrument. So in simpler terms, if I have to refine the statement, I'll put it like this. A contract gives rise to a contractual right to one party, a financial asset to one party, and a financial liability, here I will add the logic, or equity to another enterprise. Let's see, for example, we remember something which we have learned long back in our foundations and CPTs, that there can be contracts which can be settled for non-monetary consideration. What is non-monetary? Other than in cash term. So that means, let's say I am trying to pay in the form of equity shares. Let's say I tried to pay in the form of equity shares to another enterprise. So what happened? I purchased a particular item for which I said I will deliver 100 shares in my organization to the supplier. Now, for me, if I am settling it by issue of my own share, if I am actually supplying or issuing my shares, that issue of my share is going to become my share capital and not my liability. Correct? When I am settling it by paying up my own share, that becomes a share capital, which is an equity part. But think from the person who is receiving it. The supplier who is receiving the shares of my enterprise, for him, it is not equity. For him, it is properly a financial asset. It's as good as, let's say, I have done some service to Infosys. Infosys said that they will, instead of paying me cash, they will give me 1,000 shares in Infosys. I said, fine. That obligation of delivering 1,000 shares in Infosys to Infosys is an equity instrument. But if it is considered from my side, I am going to receive equity shares in Infosys, which is perfectly a financial asset. I cannot say it is my equity. It is an equity of another enterprise. Clear? Now, take any other logic as a financial instrument contract. Let's say, for example, we have, let's bring into a picture of probably a bill. I have written a bill. I've given it. Someone has accepted the bill and I got the bill back. It's a bill payable for him and bill receivable for him. I have a right to receive cash, contractual right to receive cash from that contract of a bill. The person who accepted the bill has an obligation to pay cash. So his obligation is his financial liability or equity. My right to receive cash is my financial asset. Now let's say I've used the premises of the owner for about a month. Rent became payable. Rent became payable is an obligation to me, a financial liability to me. The owner will receive the rent. He has a contractual right to receive. When he has a contractual right to receive, then I would say that it is his fund, it is a financial asset. So this way, a financial instrument is a contract which gives rise to a financial asset to one enterprise and a financial liability or equity to another enterprise. This is the logic of financial instruments. Now that we have understood this concept of financial instrument, now let's get into the first concept here, which is my financial asset. We'll have to discuss about financial asset. We'll also have to discuss about the definition of financial liability. We'll also have to discuss about the definition of equity instrument. These are the three definitions from here on. First, I'll start with financial assets. Lengthy definition, guys. Hold yourself. But once you get financial assets, I think the major chunk of the definitions will be over because liability is more or less dependent on assets out there. Now, when I talk about financial assets, guys, the first financial asset which I get in my head is cash. Anything held as cash is basically a financial asset. The second part of definition under financial asset, I'll say, I have a contractual right to receive cash. My contractual right to receive cash, this I can give certain examples out here. Can you give me examples where you have a right to receive cash? My debtors, I have a right to receive cash from them. Bills receivable, I have a right to receive cash from them. All deposits made, I made a fixed deposit, I made a rental deposit. So I'm expecting that amount of deposit to be paid back once I vacate the premises, or if the fixed deposit will mature. So I have a contractual right to receive cash out there. I'm just leaving out here, there can be etc. There are multiple others. So there are only a few which I'm naming so that you'll understand what is a contractual right to receive cash. I'll further move into this point number C. So financial asset is a cash or a contractual right to receive cash or an equity instrument of another entity. Like I just gave you the example, if I have a right to receive a share from Infosys, the share of Infosys in my hand is a financial asset for me. It's an equity instrument of another enterprise. If it is my own enterprise, then I will not call it as financial liability, I'll call it as my equity. But if it is someone else's equity instrument, which I am holding it, it is nothing but what I am indicating towards is nothing but investment there. Investment in shares or mutual funds. Even mutual funds also, unit linked, equity linked mutual funds are there, which normally come under this concept of equity instrument of another enterprise. So contractual right to receive cash or an equity instrument of another enterprise. We'll go into the fourth part. Contracts for exchange of financial assets and liabilities under conditions which are potentially favorable to the enterprise. This point number D might look long, but it is not so difficult to understand, guys. Let me put some emphasis on this potentially favorable. So what am I trying to say? I am trying to say that I am exchanging financial assets and liabilities. Where do you get this concept of exchange of financial assets and liabilities? Logic pretty simple, man. Let's say I've gone for taking a forward, okay? It's a dollar forward, which I've taken. I purchased a dollar forward, which will get executed on 15th of May at a price of 75 rupees per dollar. So I'm going to buy a forward to acquire $1 at 75 rupees per dollar on 15th of May. Standing on 1st of May, that is on today's day, the dollar rate is quoting at 76 rupees per dollar. Right? Now, the one who holds a right to receive the dollar at 75, that is me who has a right to receive the dollar, I will pay 75, receive $1. So I am exchanging cash, which is a financial asset in rupee terms, to receive another financial asset, which is exactly in dollar terms, which is also cash. So it is an exchange of financial asset and liability. Now, under conditions which are favorable to you, how is it favorable? Because the dollar rate is 76. You have a right to buy the forward at only 75. That means the condition is favorable to you. Think from the seller's point of view. You will say, sir, seller's point of view is exactly the reverse. Because if the condition is potentially favorable to me, there is no doubt that it is potentially unfavorable to the seller. Correct? Because the seller will have to sell the dollar at 75 rupees to me, even though the market is quoting at 76 rupees on today's day. So I'll put it like this. Contract for exchange of financial assets and liabilities under conditions which are potentially favorable to my enterprise is my financial asset. If it is potentially favorable to me, it is unfavorable to another enterprise. So to the enterprise to which it is unfavorable to, they will record it as a financial liability, while I'll be recording it as a financial asset. Clear? A forward contract of $1 at 75 rupees is potentially favorable if the exchange rate of $1 is greater than 75 rupees. Correct? Obviously becomes unfavorable if it is less than 75 rupees. There's no doubt about that. Now I'll go with the point number E. Look at where we stand. We started with cash, which is a financial asset, contractual right to receive cash, equity instrument of another enterprise, that is my investment in shares of another enterprise or mutual fund, units of mutual fund, contract for exchange of financial assets and financial liabilities under conditions which are potentially favorable to the enterprise. I'm looking at your comment section, guys. Any doubts, please let me know. I'll take the last point and I'll then look at the comment section, guys. The last point, that is point number E, these are nothing but contracts settled by receiving entities' own equity instruments. Contract settled by receiving entities' own equity instruments. Guys, this one would amount to buyback if I receive my own equity instrument. So many restrictions as far as Companies Act is concerned. So I would say that it is restricted by Companies Act. So I'm not emphasizing on this point. I'm not emphasizing on the last point, guys, because normally it is restricted by Companies Act unless and until certain conditions are being met. Okay. Arun, will it be available on YouTube later? Guys, unnecessary at this point of time. Saujanya, yeah, can you give me another example of point number D? Very good, fine. I'll give you one more example of point number D. For example, I have gone into a contract to purchase steel. Normally, what happens in construction contractor? Construction contract, like everyone knows what AS7 says, that contracts are for a much longer period of time than the simple 1 year contract. So same logic, I normally get into a steel contract where the steel supplier said, I'll give you steel at 44,000 rupees per metric ton. Okay, that's the average price of steel. I've taken that. The risk which I've taken out there is, even if there is a fall in the value of steel prices, because steel is normally so vulnerable material that it keeps fluctuating in price. So if I enter into a steel contract, why did I enter into a steel contract? Because it's as simple as hedging for me. Because I don't want to pay higher even if the steel prices are going up. I don't want to pay lower. I'm still fine in taking so much of risk that I'm fine because I've quoted for the contract sufficient enough to absorb that 44,000 rupees for the steel metric ton there. So I've quoted the price and I've kept on going. Now, the supplier has an obligation to deliver steel throughout the contract at 44,000 rupees per metric ton only. And I have a right to receive steel and make a payment of only 44,000 rupees throughout the tenure of the contract. Let's say, for example, during some point in the contract, the steel prices have dropped to 41,500. That means a fall of almost 3,500 rupees per metric ton is going out. In the situation where there is a fall in the value of a steel, I am exchanging my financial asset, that is cash, at 44,000 rupees to receive steel. When the market price is only 41,500, conditions are unfavorable to my enterprise. But a same contract to the supplier, he is able to sell steel at 44,000 to me because of the contract, even though the market price is much lower than that. So conditions are potentially favorable to the supplier and unfavorable to the enterprise. Clear? So these are concepts which normally become favorable to one enterprise and becomes unfavorable to another enterprise. Let's continue from here. So that will end our financial assets, guys. So I'll just browse through financial assets. A financial asset is a cash. Contractual right to receive cash, like your debtors, bills receivable, other advances or deposits, etc. Number three, equity instrument which I hold in another enterprise. If I hold shares in Infosys, I hold shares in Reliance, I hold shares in Tata. So basically, if I am holding certain shares, then each share becomes my financial asset. It's a financial asset to my enterprise, but to Reliance, Tata or to Infosys, it becomes an equity instrument and not a financial liability. Contracts for exchange of financial assets and liabilities under conditions which are potentially favorable to my enterprise becomes my financial asset. If the conditions will become potentially unfavorable, becomes a financial liability. In the example which I have given you, it is a financial asset if dollar starts quoting at more than 75. Once the dollar dips below 75, automatically the financial asset is no more. It becomes a financial liability because conditions which were earlier favorable have now become unfavorable to the enterprise. Steel example, we are not receiving cash or cash equivalents in the situation favorable. See, we are not receiving cash, guys, correct, but I have an obligation to pay cash and a supplier has a right to receive cash. So exchange of my financial liability with his financial asset is also making a contract. Clear? So yeah, if you talk about steel is not a financial asset. Steel is a physical material. But still, it is my financial liability to pay cash, his financial asset to receive cash. Only the cash component is what I'm talking about. Arun Kumar, I think that his logic is correct. Buyback is restricted as per Companies Act. Yes, so buyback unfortunately is restricted. There are certain conditions before which the buyback can be relaxed and the section starts applying. So I'm not going into that. I think company law will give you a better insight into that. Let me go into the third part. Guys, when I am trying to talk about financial liability, you know, all I'll be doing is I'll take the reference of financial asset and I'll write. Now you tell me, what is the financial asset definition? Cash. What is the opposite of cash? Nothing. Right? Don't say bank codi, okay? So bank codi is not an opposite of cash. Cash, there's nothing opposite to that. What was the second point? My second point is basically that if you are paying Arun, if you are paying, it becomes our financial liability. So basically, in the contract of steel, which I said, I have an obligation to pay cash at 44,000 rupees. And the other person has a financial asset because he has a contractual right to receive cash from. So my liability and his asset are getting exchanged. So I am giving an obligation to him and he is receiving the cash from me. So even that is absolutely fine in taking the example. All the points should be satisfied. Monica, fantastic question. No, any of them has to be satisfied. Any of the point has to be satisfied to call it as a financial asset or a financial liability. Can you take the previous slide? I'll take a screenshot. Okay, fine. I don't think so. The entire thing is fitting into one, bro. See, instead of screenshots, I think better you start writing, man. I know morning it's lazy, but Shashi, try to keep writing, okay? It always keeps you active and connected to the class if you keep writing. I'll anyway supply this sheet in PDF, man. No problem about it. But please keep writing, okay? Now, there's nothing opposite of cash. What was the second point that we were talking about? The second point under financial asset was basically we were talking about a contractual right to receive cash. And exactly right, the opposite. Contractual obligation to deliver cash. To deliver or pay cash. Can you tell me where do I have a contractual obligation? Earlier, when I said contractual right to receive cash, we gave the examples of debtors, bills receivables, and deposits. Here also, we can take similar examples. Creditor bills payable, absolutely, will become a point. Outstanding expenses is also a financial liability. If I talk about loans, yeah, whatever loan I have given, whatever loan I have taken, I'll have to repay it if I'm not Vijay Mallya. Then Shashi, I got you wrong, man. You just missed the point here. Okay, no problem. Yes, Shashi. So keep continuing, keep in track whatever we are picking up. Financial liability we are talking about. I have a contractual obligation to deliver cash. Non-current liabilities, you tell me. First one you find is term loan. Term loan, I have an obligation to pay cash to repay the loan to the banker. Correct? Provided I'm a good person, okay? I'm not talking about banks like HDIL and Yes Bank, which have got dumped because of bad loans which they have given. And the earlier PMC bank that you talk about, or you talk about Divan Housing Finance Limited, all these basically bankers have gone up for a big toss because of bad loans which they have given. Now, I would say one simple logic is, one company called HDIL, okay, a Mumbai based company, it goes into bankruptcy. It applies for bankruptcy, has pulled two major banking institutions down. It has ruined Dewan Housing Finance along with your PMC Bank. Both of them crashed heavily because of that. Yes Bank, again, has given loans in such a way that, you know, they could not recover the cash back. Now, why did they can't recover the cash? Because they were so aggressive in giving out loans that proper due diligence was not done while giving such loans or disbursing such loans. If you don't do a proper disbursal, you know, what do you mean by zone right? Please don't write to the right side, it gets covered by you. Okay, sure, ma'am. I'll take care of that, Avinash. Yes, guys, so if I'm looking at this logic, for example, how a disbursal of loan becomes important. Let's say, for example, to boost the economy today's day, if the government comes out with an initiative that RBI starts lending to the banks, which is called as a prime lending rate. PLR is nothing but a rate at which RBI lends to the bank. So if my PLR is dropping down to almost zero, I'm assuming that if such situation does appear, okay, because I think people might have already heard about this point called as quantitative easing. Quantitative easing is exactly this, where RBI starts lending to the banks at a zero rate of interest. Then what will the bank do? The banker's business is to further lend it to the, you know, to the retailers or to the general public or to big corporate houses at lower rate of interest is possible. So that means the rate of interest which we are on today's day for any loan, finding it to be much more than 10, about 11%, 12%, 12.5%. We also have certain loans which are going to about 15 to 16% based on the risk matrix. So once RBI starts lending at zero rate of interest or even further concessional rate of interest to the bankers, the banker will start reducing this amount of loan liability to the customer. So instead of lending at 11 to 14%, the banker will now bring it down to about 5 to 6%. Now when the banker starts lending at 5 to 6% to the customer, now what is the expectation? Why did this RBI actually lend it at 0%? Because I thought, as RBI, that if I give it at 0% and bank further lends it to the customers or big corporate houses, they will start creating new projects, generating new projects or new systems which can create more employment, which has become one of the biggest issue among the lockdown. Now, how can this go completely wrong is, in simple sense, if that business house is taking a new loan at a concessional rate of interest and repaying their existing loan, which is at a much higher rate of interest, which they have borrowed before this lockdown has been announced, then what happened? Is there any new project which came up? Is there any new employment which came up? These are generally things which can go wrong. I'm getting too much into economics, so let's go on. Contractual obligation to deliver cash is a financial liability. That is the first financial liability which I would talk about. Well, the second financial liability which I would be talking about. Now, look at financial assets again. Financial assets, I want exactly opposite. Equity instrument of another entity. What is the opposite? Then my equity instrument of my own entity. Right? Equity instrument of my own entity cannot be taken into consideration because equity instrument of my own entity is basically my equity instrument, not a financial liability to me. What about this one? Contracts for exchange of financial assets and liabilities under conditions which are potentially favorable is a financial asset. So exactly opposite is financial liability. Contracts for exchange of financial assets and liabilities under conditions potentially unfavorable to the enterprise. Contracts for exchange of financial assets and liabilities under conditions which are potentially favorable becomes an asset. Unfavorable, it becomes a liability. Arun, sir, what happened? What happened, man? I don't know what happened. Now let's come to point number three. What is the next opposite that I can write? Point number E. Contract settled by receiving entity's own equity instrument. You said restricted, but I can issue my own equity instrument. Contract settled by issue of entity's own equity instrument. Now someone can pull up this logic and say that, sir, if I issue my own equity instrument, how is it a financial liability? Don't you think it should be part of equity? Absolutely correct. That is where we have a conflict which comes up between financial liability and equity instrument. If you remember right at the beginning, I told you, we will discuss about this concept where we will have a conflict between financial liability and equity. Contract settled by entity's own equity instrument is also a financial liability, and that creates a conflict between financial liability and equity. Now, I'll come back to equity instruments. I'll define equity instruments and then I will start talking about it. Guys, if the stream is showing offline, please refresh the page. Please refresh the page, it should reappear again. What is an equity instrument? What do you mean by an equity instrument? An equity instrument is nothing but, it should give a right to the holder of the instrument to receive residual interest in the company. It entitles the holder of instrument to receive of the instrument to residual interest. In the enterprise. What do you mean by this? It entitles a holder to residual interest in the enterprise. What do you mean by this word, residual interest in the enterprise? Residual interest means after I pay off all my liabilities, realizing all my assets, whatever is the balance pending, residue is leftover. Whatever is the leftover which is pending, that belongs to the holder of the instrument. That is basically what we know as equity instrument. Guys, but I'm still stuck here. I'm still stuck here where I said contracts can be settled by entity's own equity instrument can be also classified as financial liability. Let me come back to this. Let's say, for example, I have a debenture. What happened is everything is fine. Yeah. So let's say I have a debentures which I have issued it, and the total face value of debentures was about 10 lakhs. Okay. Now this 10 lakh face value of debentures, I told them, each debenture holder, that at the end of 5th year, I will convert you into equity shares. I said, the debentures which I have issued today as for 10 lakhs will be converted into equity shares at the end of year 5. That is your maturity date. Now, how many equity shares? I said, it can be based on the market price on the date when I issue you the share. Or I'll say, I'll give it to you at 20% discount over the market price which is prevailing at the end of year 5. Or how many equity shares on today's day? I don't know. Why you don't know? Because I don't know what will be the price of equity share at the end of year 5. At the end of year 5, if I know what is the market price, I will take 20% discount on that. That will be my issue price. 10 lakhs divided by issue price, I will get what is the total number of equity shares. Without knowing that, then I have no idea of what is the number of equity shares I'll issue. That means it is a variable number of shares which are issued for settling a fixed consideration of 10 lakhs, that is the debentures. Clear? I'll put it one more way. I have not 10 lakh in rupee, but I have a dollar. I have a $50,000 debentures which I've issued. I'm an Indian enterprise, but I issued debentures in dollars. 50,000 debentures I issued. And I told him, again at the end of year 5, you will get converted into equity share. He asked me, how many shares will I receive? I said, I will issue you equity share at the rate of 150 rupees. I said, fine. Now, can you tell me what is the number of shares? I cannot give you the exact number of shares. I cannot tell you what is the exact number of shares because the fundamental reason going here would be, in simple logical sense, what is the value of $10,000 or $50,000 at the end of year 5? It depends on the dollar rate at the end of year 5. When you know the dollar rate at the end of year 5, I'll multiply it to 50,000 and then I will divide it by 150 rupees per share. So when I don't know what is the value of a dollar, how can I even get to know what is the value or what is the number of equity shares that I get? So even this way, it can become a variable factor. When is it fixed? Straight simple terms. I've issued 10 lakh value of debentures. For this 10 lakh value of debentures, I will give you in return 10,000 equity shares in my enterprise at the end of year 5. Straight I'm putting across to you in simple sense. I have taken 10 lakh value of debentures. In exchange of this 10 lakh debentures at the end of year 5, I'll give you 10,000 equity shares. Once I give you my settlement of 10,000 equity shares, fixed consideration, fixed number of equity shares, then it becomes an equity instrument to me. So this conflict of financial liability and equity is what I'm discussing about. I'm putting that concept up now. Financial liability versus equity. I'm trying to deliver around financial liability and equity. Now, when I say financial liability and equity, here I will go as per fixed, for fixed test. You can call it as FFF test, but normally it is called as fixed for fixed test. What is this fixed for fixed test? Logic is very simple, guys. This fixed for fixed test is nothing but the consideration payable under a contract is nothing but my contractual obligation settled by number of equity shares. Will determine what is my classification of financial asset or equity. For example, if I have a variable consideration under the contract and it is settled by variable number of equity shares. That means $50,000 of debenture at the end of fifth year will be settled by issuing equity shares to the debenture holders at a market price existing at the end of year five. $50,000 contract value, I don't know, at the end of year five, depending on the dollar rate on the date of settlement. How many equity shares will I issue? I don't know. It will depend upon the market price on the date of year five when the settlement happens. In such case, I will call it as a financial liability. Number two. If I have a fixed consideration under the consideration payable under the contract is 10 lakhs fixed, but I will settle it with equity shares depending upon the price of the equity share at the end of year 5. It will still be called as a financial liability. No change. If I have a variable consideration, that is nothing but denominated in dollars, $50,000 of a debenture contract, if I'm settling it by fixed number of equity shares, I'm saying that whatever might be the value of a dollar, that $50,000, I will settle it by paying 50,000 equity shares in the company. Story cut off. Even then, I would call it as financial liability. Then when is equity? Equity will come only in the fourth point, where the consideration payable under the contract is fixed, number of equity shares under the contract is fixed, 10 lakh is the value of debentures, they will be redeemed at the end of year 5 and their redemption will be based on 15,000 equity shares of the enterprise. Fixed to 10 lakhs, fixed to 15,000 equity shares, in such case, it will become equity instrument. This is basically what we have under fixed for fixed test. This is called as fixed for fixed test, guys. Once again, I think you people might be losing the vision because I might be covering it. I'll just reduce myself a little bit. And this should do. I'll expand it if I'm not visible at all, guys. I'll expand it if I'm not visible at all. Guys, if there is anything, please let me know. Ashida Banu, world is offline. Everything is well fine. Any doubts that we have? Any doubts that you have? Don't find any doubts out there. Guys, tell me if you have any problem with this. So that's why I said, right, financial liabilities and equity instruments are so closely bound together. So again, I'll repeat the example which I gave you. If I have a consideration payable under the contract, let's say the contract says that the contract value is denominated as in a debenture of $10,000. $10,000, when I said, it's a variable consideration payable under the contract at the end of the maturity date of 5 years. Why is it variable? Because at the end of 5 years, the value of the contract will be dependent on the value of dollar at the end of year five. Therefore, it is variable. Whenever the consideration payable under the contract is variable, irrespective of what is the number of equity shares, either you can issue equity shares based on market price at the end of year 5, or I can issue fixed number of equity shares which I made promise. In whichever way possible, it is always a financial liability. If I have a fixed consideration payable under a contract, what is a fixed consideration? I have issued debentures worth rupees 10 lakhs which are redeemable at the end of year 5. That is a fixed consideration payable under the contract. If the contract is settled by issuing equity shares based on market price at the end of year 5, then what is the number of equity shares? Even I don't know. Because it is dependent upon the market price at the end of year 5, which I cannot predict on today's date. Therefore, in such cases, it will still be called as financial liability. But if the fixed consideration of the contract of 10 lakhs, if I have given you a commitment at the end of year 5, I will redeem the debenture by converting into equity shares, and I will issue 15,000 equity shares on the date of redemption. Fixed share, fixed consideration becomes an equity instrument. Clear? This is the concept, what we call it as fixed for fixed test. Some noise, I'll check it, no problem, guys. If I go up and look at where we go, we exactly covered this point and this point, where the definitions and equity versus financial liability, that is fixed for fixed test, we have already checked. Now we will have to go into compound financial accounting and financial instruments and look at split accounting before I get into the concept of classification of financial instruments or classification of financial assets, which is a very important concept. Guys, we will break for about 10 minutes. I think we are running the stream for more than an hour and a half now. You can take a break for about 10 minutes. I'll offline the stream immediately right now. I'll go online again after 10 minutes. Guys, please make sure that don't delay the process. Now, 1 second. Can you please explain the reason why, if consideration or number of equity shares is variable, why is it classified as financial liability? Guys, those who want to take a break, you can take a break right across immediately. Yeah. So like you asked me a good question, why is it called as a financial liability when it is variable? In logical sense, I'll put it like this. If I basically look at an equity share, okay, which is issued based on market price on a future date, then I am not looking at equity instrument. I am dealing that equity instrument as a currency note itself. I am treating that equity share as a currency note itself, because I have no intention to make him as a part of my management or my investor as my shareholder. I am compromising, saying that if my value of shares would be higher, then I might give him a different price. That means basically whenever you have a fixed for fixed test, what does it mean? It is nothing but 10 lakh value of shares, I'll give you 15,000 shares. What did I do? 10 lakh value of debentures, if I give you 15,000 shares. But I will not issue today, I will issue at the end of year 5. Guys, fundamentally, it is nothing but that 10 lakh is a consideration for the share. Right? But what did you do? For 5 years period, I will keep paying you interest. After that, I will convert you into equity share, is what you're saying. So there, I find it exactly in the form of equity instrument. In all other cases where either of the consideration is variable or the number of equity share is variable, I do not find it equivalent to issue of shares for cash. It is not equivalent to that. You are playing around with the value of the contract, or you are playing around with the value of the share. There, I do not have an intention of equity out there. Clear? For me to classify it as equity, I should know how many shares I issue, and I should know what is the consideration I receive from the contract. That is, by issuing the share, how much consideration I got, how many shares am I issuing. If these two I know, then it is my equity. If it is not known, either of them is not known, that means I am not treating it as an equity instrument, but I am treating it as a liability for us next year. Yes, guys? That is the explanation there. We'll get into compound financial instruments immediately. We'll get into compound financial instrument, guys, immediately once you are done with this. I'll take this theme offline for 10 minutes, guys. Immediately after 10 minutes, I want you people to be back. Please, no delays, guys. About 43 people streaming. Make sure that you take the time off, have some water, go to the washroom, make sure that you come back soon. I'll see you guys in 10 minutes.